Hello and welcome to the St. Andrew's Society of Los Angeles podcast. Each episode will bring you the latest news from the St. Andrew's Society of Los Angeles, as well as fascinating interviews with entertainment personalities, government leaders, and community advocates. St. Andrew's Society of Los Angeles, where Scotland meets the City of Angels. Let's get started. Everybody, and welcome to another great episode of the St. Andrew's Society of Los Angeles. I know it's been some time, but we have got a show for you today. First, I want to introduce to you our guest co-host, Gwen Goldblum. Gwen Goldblum has worked in television marketing and promotion for almost two decades. The heads up brand and franchise management for Fox 21 Television Studios, Gwen was born and raised by an American father and a Scottish mother. So please welcome Gwen Goldblum. Hello, Gwen.
Hi, thank you. Thank you. This is, I'm so excited to do this. I'm so happy that you guys invited me.
We are excited to have you here, especially given your kind of your background. This is going to be such a great conversation. And our guest today is a man who really needs no introduction because you've seen him in everything, whether you know it or not. He is best known as Gior Mormont and Lord Commander of the Night's Watch in Game of Thrones, or you may have seen him as Angus MacLeod in Highlander, or you may have seen him in one of his many other films that he's been in, such as Braveheart, Trainspotting, which is one of my favorites, Sons of Anarchy, Wonder Woman, just to name a few. Please welcome the legendary actor of television and film, the delightful James Cosmo.
Hey, how are you, everyone? You're all good?
Yes, very
doing
much.
Great.
So, James, I heard that you are in Hungary right now shooting a film. Can you give us some details?
Yeah, well, I'm not so much a film. It's the Jack Ryan series for Amazon. And I've been here in beautiful downtown Budapest for longer than I care to remember. it's been, as I say, 5 months nearly. And I'm just going a bit stir crazy now. although, when I first arrived in March, we were right in the middle of all the terrible COVID stuff that was going on. And quite rightly, the film company, Paramount, who are making it for Amazon, or Jeff, as I know, you know, my pal Jeff, they're very, very careful about COVID regulations. So I arrived in Budapest from my home outside London, went for costume fitting, and got to my hotel, the beautiful Four Seasons in Budapest. And the phone was ringing when I get into my room. And they said, you've been in contact with someone who has tested positive for COVID. And you are now restricted to your bedroom for 2 weeks.
Oh, my.
So I arrived in Budapest and looked out the window for 2 weeks. Like some prisoner, a very comfortable, well looked after prisoner, but a prisoner nonetheless. So that was my introduction to Jack Ryan. That was quite interesting. But the rest of it has been a bit more exciting than staring at the wallpaper.
That is sad and hilarious at the same time.
Wow. Yeah,
gives you time to catch up on books or binge TV and films on the telly.
Well, yeah, I guess it did a bit, Gwen. Yeah, but you know that way when you've got plenty of time, that's when you prevaricate.
So, James, you know, thank you again for taking the time to speak with us. This is so amazing. It's such a pleasure to meet you virtually. I've watched a lot of your films and TV shows, and I remember Highlander very well, and I love that movie. Braveheart.
Yeah, it was good.
But what's your sort of earliest memory of wanting to be an actor? I mean, did your father have some influence in the decision, or did it come about a different way?
Well, I think, Gwen, my father never helped me in my career. He didn't think that that was appropriate, that one should make one's own way in your career. But what I did get from him being an actor was that I was very aware of the circumstances of being an actor. Being out of work, and then the elation of getting a job, and then the deflation when the job's finished. You think you're never going to work again. There's no secure income. So I went into the business with my eyes wide open, realizing that that's how it can be. And and being unsuccessful is predominantly the situation of most actors. As they say, 90% of actors are unemployed at any given time. There's not many jobs that are equal to that or have the same difficulties. So I went into it with my eyes wide open and ready for it, and knowing that stickability, just being able to understand that another job will come along, was always the case, So I think I was at a slight advantage, and I loved. My father was in a long, very long running play in the West End for years when I was a little boy, between 8 and 11, and I used to go up and visit him on a Saturday when I was off school, and I would go into his dressing room, and I always remember sitting there. Actors in the olden days used to carry around their own stage makeup, and they were usually in old cigar boxes, old cedar Havana cigar boxes, and they came in tubes. And they were numbered. And because the lighting was not as good as it is nowadays for the stage, the makeup was quite pronounced. And they would put on, it was grease paint. It was thick. And it was called the 7 and 8s. It was the two different tubes that they put on. And I can still remember the smell of them. Literally, the smell of the grease paint. I remember that as a little boy, sitting there watching my father getting ready to go on stage. So I was aware of that. And I think once I had my first taste of acting, although it was terrifying at the time, I got slightly addicted to that frisson of fear and that wonderful feeling of elation when it's over, which is never left me, really.
Oh, wow. They I think they do say that your sense of smell is the strongest connected to your memories. You can just smell something, it takes you back immediately.
Absolutely.
Or vice versa, I assume.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. If I smell old theatrical grease paint, that would take me immediately back to that dressing room. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Oh, that's exciting. Did your father get to see you perform in, film and television? Was he sort of around when you had, arrived?
Yes, he did before he passed away. He was, I wouldn't say lucky enough, but he saw me in plenty of movies, and he was pleased that I was doing okay, because that was very nice to see both he and my mother.
That's fantastic. So I understand that you come from Clydebank, Dumbartonshire. Let me say that again.
That's it, yes.
Dumbartonshire. I actually asked my mother before I got on here. I'm like, how do you pronounce this? Because I know that's, you know, it's always different.
Yeah.
So Clydebank, Dumbartonshire. Is that
that's
right?
That's it. All
right.
That's
perfect.
It. Yeah.
What is your sort of hometown? What is it known for? What are you sort of?
Well, Gwen, I was actually born in the town of Dumbarton, which is a little bit away from Clydebank, a few miles away. And then when I was quite young, we moved up to a district in Clydebank called Dalmuir. And we lived there in a tenement. This was just after the war, you know, late 40s, I think. Funnily enough, my mother always told me that where I was born was the cottage hospital in Dumbarton, and the shipyard that had produced the Cutty Sark, that wonderful tea clipper, which the whiskey is named after, and you know, all those wonderful stories of the greatest tea clipper in the world, who had famous races with another tea clipper called Thermopylae, and they would race from India to Bristol, usually with a cargo of tea. But the Cutty Sark, the finest, was built on the slips where the cottage hospital ended up. Mm-hmm. So myself and the greatest sailing ship in the world were born in the same place. So I have a great soft spot for Robert Burns. I'm a great admirer of his work, and also the Cutty Sark.
Okay, I'm going to switch gears just a little bit, as we've spoken before. I mean, obviously, you're very well known for Highlander and Braveheart and your role on Game of Thrones. And, you know, obviously, you were become well known for those roles and had a very successful career. But is there a role earlier on, because you obviously had much of a career before then, that you sort of pinpoint as the moment that your career accelerated, or the one role that sort of took you on your way?
Well, I up until I did Braveheart, I had a sort of decent career. I'd done Highlander before that, and the Battle of Britain before that, when I was 20. I had been making a decent living, but Braveheart seemed to, you know, being such a huge success as it was, and it resonated, that message of liberty resonated in so many hearts. That elevated me, not through any talent of mine, but it elevated me within the business, because by association, you know, if you're in a very successful movie, you tend to be regarded strangely as a sort of better than normal. So I would have to say that's a, you know, that was the film that changed everything, you know. Mm-hmm. And mighty grateful I am for it, you know.
When you first started with filming Braveheart, or first, you know, got hired for the role, what did you think about an Australian / American, because Mel Gibson was originally American.
He was, yeah.
Being the role, you know, being in the role of William Wallace. Was that couldn't they have found a Scottish actor, kind of, or no?
Yes, they could have. Absolutely, they could have. Only one drawback: they could never have made the film.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The fact was that Mel wanted to direct that film. He had been given the script by Randall Wallace, the screenwriter, and he'd looked at it and put it down and looked at it again for a couple of years. And then he decided, this is a film I want to make. Mm-hmm. I want to direct this film. And he went to the studio and said, I want to direct this. It's going to cost $80 million or something. Huge amount of money at that time. Mm-hmm. Still is a huge amount of money, but it was more than that in those days. And they said, absolutely, Mel, terrific, you can direct it, only if you play William Wallace. that was the one demand that they had. Mm-hmm. So, and I thought Mel did a great job of
it. He did a very good job.
He was fantastic in it, and great to work with. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you a funny story. I'd actors of periods of unemployment, which I'm well used to. Well, I was well used to. I'm lucky to be able to work mostly when I want now. But at that time, I'd been out of work for a while, and my wife Annie and I had just been blessed with our first son, who was a babe in arms. He was about 6 months old or something. Mm-hmm. And Annie worked at the BBC in production. But we got together when I was older, you know, I was early 40s. And we were living in a one-bedroom flat in Twickenham in London. And we just had a tiny little kitchen, the living room, and then the bedroom. And we had a futon, you know, one of these Japanese beds.
Yep.
Where Annie, myself, and the baby slept all together. And a rocking chair that Annie had borrowed from her mum, and an old TV. We didn't have anything else because we were trying to save money or not spend mm-hmm. too much money, because we didn't know when I was working again. So I was living off Annie, and I was looking after the baby, which I loved. But the one treat of the week that we had was an Indian curry on a Saturday night. And 27 years ago, you just watched whatever was on TV. But Saturday night, mm-hmm. there was always a movie on about 10 o'clock or something on a Saturday night, you know, because they know that people come back from the pub and sit down and watch the TV. So I used to time it so the curry would come at 10 o'clock and I could sit down and watch the thing. Well, I'd had a general meeting, if you like, with Mel about 8 months before, and just a 5-minute thing where I was introduced to him, and he was thinking about making a movie over here, whatever, and I'd completely forgotten about it. Anyway, it comes at 10 o'clock or 10:30 nearly. The film's on, my curry's there, and I'm eating my curry. And the phone rang. 10:30 at night, and I sort of said to Annie, could you answer that, because I thought it was my friend Dominic, you know. I said, if that's Dominic, I said, just say I'll see him tomorrow, I'll see him in the pub tomorrow at lunchtime, but I just want to watch the film, I don't want to talk to anyone. She said, yeah, sure. And she answered the phone and said, hello, yeah, oh, right, okay, would you just hang on? I said, Annie, what are you doing? I said, I just said I want to watch the film. Say I'm going to bed, whatever. And Annie said, it's Mel Gibson, and handed me the phone. And I thought, oh, please, don't be so silly. And again, I thought it was Dominic, because he was always doing silly things.
Oh, my gosh.
And I said, hello, Dom. He went, no, it's Mel. I said, Mel, yeah, Mel who? And he went, Mel Gibson. And it suddenly clicked, and I went, oh, dear God. And he said, hey, James, do you want to come and play Campbell? You know, the old guy that goes right through the movie. And I said, oh, yeah, I think I would, Mel, yeah. And he said, great, I'll see you next week. I'm flying over. And that was it.
So you got the role without, you know, just on your reputation, not you didn't have to read for it or anything like
He'd seen my showreel. He'd seen my showreel, and he'd decided then. So that was wonderful. You know, I always remember standing, looking out the window, thinking this could change everything. And it did.
It takes you back to that time where you couldn't pause the TV to sort of, you know, answer
go to the
bathroom.
No.
Oh, man. That is a great story. I love that. Well, actually, kind of speaking of people and meeting people, I heard that there was this unique way that you met Sir Sean Connery. Can you tell us that story as well?
Well, my when my dad was in the show, the play that he was doing, he had lots of friends, actors, that some were out of work, some were working. They all were in the same sort of melange. But my dad had a regular wage coming in, and my mum used to, every Sunday, she would cook her curry. Not the curry that we know of nowadays, but it was my mum's idea of a curry, which meant adding a huge amount of curry powder to a stew. That was it. Just a tin of curry powder. That'll do it. So she used to make a big curry and loads of rice, and lots of actors came round the Sunday. They would all go to the Red Lion and Sun, the pub up the road, and then they would come back at 3 o'clock after having a few beers, starving, hungry, and my mum would feed them. And Sean was amongst that. He was working on South Pacific in the chorus at that time. And we used to, after Sunday lunch, we would go onto Hampstead Heath and play cricket together and all that sort of stuff. So I met lots and lots of actors who became, you know, Peter O'Toole, I knew when I was a little boy, and then worked with him when I was much, much older, and he was very elderly. But we picked up that friendship once again, which was an absolute delight. Yeah, so I had a strange sort of dichotomy of a life between meeting all these famous people and then going back to the tenements of Glasgow. But yeah, there you go. And as far as I'm concerned, the only James Bond. Yes. After he stopped doing James Bond, I stopped watching. He brought genuine danger to that character. And I think he was the closest to Ian Fleming's idea of a Bond. You know, he was sophisticated, but there was an animal element to him. And I thought he just played it. They are films of the time, but I thought he played them beautifully. And I remember Cubby Broccoli being interviewed, and he said when he and Harry Saltzman were after they'd met Connery for some sort of meeting, and they were wondering about, you know, Bond, and they had an office, and Cubby looked out of the window, and Connery was walking across the street. And he said he walked like a panther. And I knew that was James Bond. Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, he was a one-off, Sean. An absolute one-off. He was a real film star.
And how about the difference of playing historical figures and just fictional characters? Are historical figures sort of harder because, especially if they're well-known, because people have, well, there's the quote-unquote truth of their history, or how people perceive
exactly.
them as.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's a really interesting question, Gwen, because as you rightly say, we look at historical characters and their traits and personalities have been explored and then set in stone, you know, and that's not necessarily who they were or what they were, you know, because we love to create heroes and we love to listen to myths and endow human people, ordinary people, with amazing attributes, which they may have displayed at times, but at other times they probably didn't. You know, so yeah, it's interesting. I haven't played that many real historical characters, but the ones that I have portrayed, I've tried to make them to show that they're human, just the same as everyone else. I remember I did a a wonderful, the BBC in the old days used to do a play of the month, and they were fantastic. They were fantastic at these plays, which are 90 minutes long. And one of them was about a guy called Ord Wingate, who led the Chindits in Burma in the Second World War. Very famous man. He was famous at the time. Very eccentric. And his second in command was a guy called Brigadier Mike Calvert. And I played Mike Calvert. And I was 6'2½, a great big lump, ready blonde hair and things. And then after the show, I met Mike Calvert, who was he'd got through the war and he was fine. He was about 5'4" and square. So I thought, well, that wasn't a very good portrayal then, was it? Slightly romanticized. But yeah.
Speaking of characters that you've played, when you landed the role on Game of Thrones, did you have any idea how much of a cult following that was going to have?
No. I actually hadn't heard of the books. Because I think they were quite a niche market, you know, that sort of fantasy thing. But I remember they asked me to come up and read, just to go on tape for Lord Mormont. And they sent me over 2 pages of, it was a big long speech about joining the Night Watch. And I read it through and I thought, wow, this is a really interesting character. And what are they all about, this Night Watch and things? And usually when you go on tape, you know, you can hold the pages in front of you and just read, you know, it's fine. But I thought, no, I'm going to work at this. So I worked all night at it and worked really hard getting it off. And it's funny that the process usually in these sort of big shows, it was a big show. They were putting a lot of money in and having a go, see what would happen. But, you know, you go through all sorts of processes to play a sort of important character, and you know, you go on tape and then the casting director watches it, and then the not so much the director, because they come and go, but then the executive producers watch it, and then that goes, it goes to the studio, and then the studio talks to the, it goes on forever. Mm-hmm. Well, I went on tape 1 week, and then 2 weeks later, I got an email from George Martin, the writer, mm-hmm. saying, "Dear Lord Commander, welcome to Game of Thrones."
That extra effort just cut you through the line all the way to the end.
It did. And I do encourage actors when they go on tape, you know, to go on as professionally as you can, mm-hmm. you know, give the best performance you can, because that's what will get you the job at the end.
Now, did you read the books subsequently? Like, after getting the role, did you read the books to get a sense?
No, I never do, Gwen, because mm-hmm. sometimes there is such a jump between the written piece and then what is made into the TV show.
I have to say, you mentioned that they, you know, spent a decent amount of money on Game of Thrones. Well, you know, standing over at 20th Century Fox Television studio, I mean, at the time, we were just looking over at HBO going, oh my God, those budgets. We don't even have like a 20th of those budgets.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you're right. You know, in fact, when I turned up, I just finished doing Sons of Anarchy, and I flew over to Belfast from the States, and went up, they were filming outside Belfast. It just looked like the set of a big movie. No difference. Three mm-hmm. cameras set up, same number of folk. You're shooting a big movie. And then mm-hmm. you remember that they had 2 other units, one in Croatia and right. one in Morocco, just as big, shooting at mm-hmm. the same time. I mean, that's ambitious.
Yeah. I mean, it is very interesting because, you know, sort of the business models between the two studios, you know, HBO is subscription. It's not supported by advertising. So yeah. Basically they're making these shows to get more subscribers to the, you know, yeah. to the platform and spending yeah. a lot of money where, you know, at sort of other studios, including 20th, you know, you're making stuff that's ad supported. So you're getting big media buys that's helping to, you know, offset yeah. production. And so it's interesting how you would think that ad buys and the money you get from, you know, the media would be sort of more easy to
yeah.
you know, make back millions and millions and millions of dollars per episode. But, you know, you also get awards and it elevates the status of the network. And
yeah.
they've done a good job, yeah. HBO.
they seem to have an uncanny knack for mm-hmm. for picking a good show. They mm-hmm. really have. Yeah. Yeah. And putting yeah. the money where the mouth is.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Until Netflix came along and now they're spending tremendous amounts of money on productions.
Oh, I
and,
know.
And winning a lot of awards.
Yeah. 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 It's a complete change, isn't it? In yeah. the paradigm. It's
yeah.
It's
they've
all
definitely,
different now, yeah.
yeah. Shift, totally flipped the, you know, TV studio business and networks on their head. But is there an actor or a director that you would love to work with that you haven't yet?
I've been asked that question a few times, and a day later I can answer it, which is a bit not very helpful. Mm-hmm. I loved working with Danny Boyle. I'd work any time with Danny. He's a hugely, hugely talented director. As far as actors go, I think actors, myself included, I think a lot of actors can be fantastic in a part. That's not to say there will be fantastic actors in right. every part, you know. And I think if you look at it in retrospect, you'd say, oh, God, it'd be great to have been in that show. But the circumstances might have been different. You just don't know. I think it's got so much to do with chemistry, you know, mm-hmm. between you and the director, you and the other actors. So although, you know, you say, oh, it'd be wonderful to work with, I don't know, Matthew McConaughey. I'm a huge mm-hmm. fan of his. I think mm-hmm. he's a hugely talented actor and a very smart guy. But that would be the best of all worlds.
Mm-hmm.
If we got on together, if we clicked, if we
right.
were on the same wavelength, that might not happen. You know, the same with any director. You know, I remember David Lean. I went up to see David Lean about a film called Passage to India many years ago. At that time, he was probably one of the top three most famous directors in the world, you know, and I couldn't wait to meet him. I couldn't wait. I was so excited that I was going to meet and probably work with David Lean. And within 5 minutes, we were arguing, and we never worked together.
I can't do this.
It was, you know, it wasn't meant to be. And I'm a great believer in what's meant to be. I'm a great believer in, what is it Desiderata says, the world is unfolding as it should. Mm-hmm. I'm a great believer in that.
You know, I really have wanted to know. I mean, you've certainly worked on both sides of the pond and every other, right, you know, place. But in your opinion, do you think there's a difference between being on an American production and being on a British production, whether it's film or television? Are they sort of run the same way? Is a sort of pecking order seems the same? The creature yeah, comforts that, for talent the same?
There's certainly a difference, Gwen. Yeah. And each of them has the benefits. It's lucky that we, the, you know, British and American industries share the same technical expertise. You know, you can literally go anywhere in either country, and the technicians are all incredibly talented people, just so good. I wouldn't say the actors get treated better in America. They get more obvious benefits, you know. You know, little things like craft services, which has started to come in the UK now as well. But, you know,
that's a staple on American productions. Absolutely. I love crafty.
Absolutely.
Although it's dangerous, though, because there's so many yummy sweets and all sorts of...
Oh, absolutely. You know. Absolutely. Trying to get the crew back from there, yeah. But I would say in general, it's pretty much the same, you know? I think the criteria is more budget-related than anything else. You know, and I think everyone accepts that when you're working on a high budget film, you know that it's things are going to be easier. The car's going to pick you up, and there'll be a nice driver there, and he'll have a cup of coffee for you, and you'll you get looked after. But then when I finish this in 3 weeks' time, I'm going over to the west coast of Ireland to shoot a very moderately budgeted film with a Finnish director, Klaus Haro, and that will be very, very different, you know. But it's the same process. It's you know, you're creating characters and things, and shooting medium budget films has an advantage to it, because it's a much more personal, much more collaborative feel when you're on the set, because people aren't there necessarily to make as much money as they can, as quickly as they can, and get out. You know, they're doing it because they want to be there and they want to make something special. And I still get a real buzz out of that, you know. So I think it's more budget related than anything. There's less fun on an American production, usually.
Interesting. They get down to business.
They get down to business really quickly. And but it's always nice to go in as a Brit and at least try and have some fun when you're on the set, you know? Because if you're not enjoying yourself, there's not much point in being there, you know? As long as you get the job done, you know?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. I guess also, speaking of being a Brit, so, and being a Scot, like when you're traveling around and, you know, if you're on different productions in the States or whatever, do you find that you're sort of a representative of Scotland or the UK? And do people always ask you, like, what are their perceptions of what it's like to be Scottish or what it's like to be British? Do they ask you certain questions? I mean, you know, I hear that almost everyone asks Scottish men about what is worn under the kilt. Is that something like, is there anything that people always ask you about what it's like to be Scottish, or?
Not so much what it's like to be Scottish. I wouldn't say I was proud to be Scottish. I feel very privileged to have been born a Scot. I think that's the best way of putting it. Because to get serious for a second, you know, I think, well, maybe not in the Caledonian society, but I think in general, the continent of America and Canada and Australia, New Zealand, and so many other places is rather unaware of the extraordinary gift that Scotland gave to Western civilization. When one thinks of the Scottish Enlightenment and David Hume and Adam Smith, and you know, during that period of the early 18th century, and the tragedy of the Highland clearances, when the people were driven off the land, was a huge gift to the rest of the world, because all those Scots arrived, and not only did the Scottish Enlightenment inform the founding fathers in America to a huge extent, they had an ongoing contribution in the development of the United States of America and Canada and other places. Yep. Your educational system is purely Scottish, or derived purely from Scotland. So many things. So I'm very proud of those people who went over and made a country, along with many other nationalities, but Scotland's input was
huge,
continued to be so for many, many years, and that's something that we should all be very proud of, you know. And funnily enough, I'll let you into a little secret that I bought as a parting gift for John Krasinski, who plays Jack Ryan. I bought him a little book of the collected works of Robert Burns. And not only he was Abraham, Burns was, as you probably know, Abraham Lincoln's one of his favorite poets. And he carried a book of Burns' work with him most of the time to refer to. And I can't remember it verbatim, so I shan't say it, but when he was asked to give a eulogy to Burns at one point, he made a lovely speech saying that he was far too ill qualified to give a critique of such a great man. So that's, you know, the words of Burns resonate so strongly in the Declaration of Independence that Burns supported completely. They ring like a bell a beacon of liberty and freedom. And we should always be grateful for people like that.
I know we talked about Tom Clancy's Jack Ryan coming out on Amazon. That's what you're working on right now. Coming out next year. Is there anything else in the pipeline on the horizon for you for projects, or you're looking to take a wee break after that?
Well, as I say, I go home for about 3 weeks, and then I go over to Ireland to shoot this film, the Sailor, My Sailor, My Love, it's called, and to work with this director called Klaus Harrow, who won the Golden Bear at Berlin and the Ingmar Bergman Prize. So he sent me a film of his called The Fencer, which was just gorgeous, just beautiful, so beautifully shot, and the pace of it was perfect, and it was a very nuanced film, which told a very simple story but with so much backstory. It was wonderful, so I'm looking forward to working with him tremendously. So that'll take me up till November. And then I'll have Christmas off. And then I think I'm doing a film in the States after that, but I'm not sure. We shall see. Actors can only look so far ahead.
Right.
All right, James, thanks so much for taking the time today. I don't know about you, but I had a blast. I love the stories and just kind of hearing how everything goes and went in your history. And this was a lot of fun. James, if somebody wanted to keep up with your upcoming projects or follow you on any of the socials, Do you have all of that stuff, like an Instagram or any of that?
I have people that do that. I wouldn't know how to do a Twitter, but I know that I've got a Twitter account. Mm-hmm. I've got a website, jamescosmo.com, and they can send in questions or whatever, and they can get up to date on whatever I'm doing. I guess it's all out there.
It is. It probably
it is.
Well, we will definitely put that link in the show notes as well as on our on the YouTube video as well. So, James, thanks so much. Gwen, thanks so much for being my co-host today.
Thank you for inviting me. I had such a blast. And James, like I said before, such a pleasure to meet you and chat with you.
Again, you guys have been watching and listening to the St. Andrew Society of Los Angeles podcast. We will see you on our next episode. Thanks again, guys. Thank you so much for listening to this week's episode of the St. Andrew Society of Los Angeles podcast. For more information on the St. Andrew Society of Los Angeles, visit www.standrewsla.org. And don't forget to like our Facebook page, Instagram, and YouTube channels as well. Have a great week, and we'll see you next episode.